Boa tarde a todas, todos, todes. Daremos início à mesa de abertura seguida da primeira aula pública ministrada pela socióloga e professora emérita da Universidade de Maryland, Patricia Hill Collins. O evento é organizado pelo Programa de Pós-Graduação em Ciências Sociais da EFELESH, Campus Guarulhos, por meio do Programa de Especialistas da Fundação Fulbright, com o apoio da Associação Nacional de Pesquisa em Ciências Sociais, ANPOCS. Convido, nesse momento, para compor a mesa de abertura, o pró-reitor adjunto de pós-graduação e pesquisa, o professor doutor Fernando Atiki. Convido o diretor acadêmico da Escola de Filosofia, Letras e Ciências Humanas, o professor doutor Bruno Konder Comparato. Convido a coordenadora do Programa de Pós-Graduação em Ciências Sociais, a professora doutora Melvina Afra Mendes de Araújo. Convido a professora doutora Mariana Chaguri, da Associação Nacional de Pós-Graduação em Ciências Sociais, ANPOCS. Convido também Patrícia Grijó, gerente de programas na Comissão Fulbright Brasil. Passo a palavra à Patrícia Grijó, gerente de programas da Comissão Fulbright Brasil.
Bom, boa tarde, quase boa noite. Estou sendo surpreendida aqui por abrir a programação. A minha fala não está muito apropriada para uma abertura, acho que os professores aqui é que vão ter essa incumbência e honra, mas eu agradeço pela oportunidade de estar aqui, esse auditório super cheio. Não sou a Patrícia, por quem vocês vieram, mas espero que vocês me escutem só uns 5 minutinhos. Eu vou aproveitar a oportunidade, super, super breve, para falar da Fulbright e do programa Fulbright Specialist, que foi o programa que propiciou a vinda da professora Patrícia Collins, né? Então, eu, mais uma vez, agradeço aos professores da Unifesp, aos organizadores do evento, professora Melvina, professora Mariana, da ANPOCS. E, bom, eu queria dizer que a Fulbright existe no mundo há 77 anos, no Brasil há 66, é uma organização já que tem uma certa idade, né, e está presente em 160 países. Nós temos a missão de promover o entendimento entre os povos dos Estados Unidos e os de outros países, através dos intercâmbios de oportunidades educacionais, culturais e da troca de conhecimento. Então, nesse tempo de existência, a Fulbright já concedeu 400 mil bolsas de estudos para cidadãos americanos e cidadãos de outros países. Sobre o programa Fulbright Specialist, é um programa específico para trazer um especialista profissional, acadêmico, americano para o Brasil. Então, é uma oportunidade para as instituições brasileiras, não só universidades, para apresentarem um projeto para receber um especialista que vá se envolver, vai ser vinculado a um projeto que a instituição apresenta para a Fulbright. Então, os especialistas, quando eles vêm, eles ficam de 14 a 42 dias, é um programa de curta duração, e eles podem participar de diversas atividades, como formação de currículo, dar seminários, minicursos, realizar pesquisas colaborativas e iniciar uma produção iniciar um relacionamento com a instituição que está convidando e a sua instituição nos Estados Unidos, né? O que amplia as possibilidades para que outras pessoas sejam envolvidas nessa oportunidade. Então, existe um protocolo para a instituição brasileira se candidatar, que consiste basicamente da apresentação de um projeto e do compromisso de arcar com uma pequena contrapartida financeira que cubra a hospedagem e a alimentação do especialista enquanto ele está aqui no Brasil. É um processo muito simples, que o nosso escritório da Fulbright aqui em São Paulo ajuda a avançar, dá toda a orientação, todo o suporte. E, realmente, para as instituições interessadas, eu garanto que é um processo simples. Tá? Então, como eu disse, vocês não eram a Patrícia. Eu não sou a Patrícia que vocês vieram aqui ouvir, mas eu acho que é uma informação que vale a pena esse público aqui de estudantes, de professores, pesquisadores, todos podem se mover para promover, junto com a Fulbright, a vinda de um especialista. Bom, era isso que eu gostaria de dizer, e desejo um evento de muito sucesso. Agradeço aqui o grande trabalho da professora Melvina, que foi a minha interlocutora nesse último ano, praticamente, né, professora? E a professora Patrícia Collins, não sei se está presente, mas também desejo que ela tenha uma rica experiência e que ela volte ao Brasil, que ela fique com a vontade de continuar. Muito obrigada.
Passo a palavra agora para Mariana Chaguri, da Ampox.
Obrigada. Bom, também vou ser super breve, começar pelos agradecimentos. Quero agradecer primeiro à Patrícia, a primeira Patrícia sem a qual a gente não estaria aqui, pelo todo o profissionalismo e cuidado nessa parceria da Fulbright com a Ampox. Enfim, acho que a Fulbright fez muitos atalhos e tornou tudo muito mais simples para os filiados da Ampox nesse processo de... tanto do processo de seleção, das primeiras propostas, de criar um edital, de criar um programa que fosse afinado ao perfil dos programas de pós-graduação em ciências sociais no Brasil, de abrir uma linha de financiamento há 2 anos atrás, num momento muito difícil para a ciência brasileira, em particular para as ciências sociais. A gente estava sofrendo um processo de desfinanciamento muito profundo, e acho que a Fulbright abriu uma porta que é bastante importante, como a gente está vendo aqui, para o fomento do ensino, da pesquisa em ciências sociais no Brasil. Então, enfim, agradeço muitíssimo a parceria da Fulbright, agradeço muitíssimo o interesse da Unifesp em lá atrás também pleitear uma vaga no nosso programa de parceria com a Fulbright. Esse programa surgiu na gestão passada da Ampox, sob a direção do professor André Botelho, da Universidade Federal do Rio de Janeiro, que tinha o professor Bruno também como membro da nossa diretoria. Então, foi um esforço da Ampox de começar a, de fato, tentar promover políticas científicas redistributivas para os nossos filiados. A gente acredita fortemente que uma Associação Nacional de Pesquisa em Pós-Graduação em Ciências Sociais não pode ser forte se ela não tiver programas de pós-graduação em Ciências Sociais fortes. E a nossa expectativa é sempre essa: conseguir fortalecer a ciência social feita no Brasil, conseguir fortalecer as possibilidades de cooperação internacional dos nossos múltiplos filiados, entendendo que nós temos filiados dos mais variados perfis de norte a sul do Brasil. O programa de parceria tem 9 contemplados, além da Unifesp, em todas as regiões do Brasil, que é uma coisa que nos anima muito. Enfim, então, nós temos programas contemplados no norte, no nordeste, no centro-oeste, no sul. Isso é realmente algo que nos anima muito, e nos interiores também, enfim, em cidades pequenas. A gente conseguiu contemplar esse processo de interiorização das ciências sociais no Brasil e tentar fomentar e apoiar a internacionalização desses programas. Então, enfim, é muito satisfatório, assim, 2 anos depois, ver um auditório cheio, ver que as coisas que a gente começa a construir lá atrás vão dando frutos. Então, enfim, reforço um pouco o convite da Patrícia para que todo mundo também conheça a Fulbright, conheça as bolsas para os estudantes. Existem muitas oportunidades também de intercâmbio intercâmbio e cooperação internacional que vem por esses caminhos. Enfim, as portas estão sempre abertas. Convido vocês também a sempre participar das atividades da Unpox. A gente tem um encontro se aproximando em outubro na Unicamp, aqui pertinho de Guarulhos. Enfim, espero que vocês também tenham interesse de acompanhar o nosso encontro, que começa, acho que no dia 19 de outubro, se eu não estiver enganada. Já falei demais, não vou me alongar, porque também ninguém veio aqui me ouvir. Então, enfim, só agradecer muitíssimo ao Melvina, porque a gente sabe também que um programa como esse só ganha carne e osso porque alguém pega para tocar desde o começo, em cada pequeno detalhe, e a gente sabe quanto isso é trabalhoso e o quanto tempo de trabalho, de cuidado existe envolvido nisso. Então, parabéns também para você. Obrigada.
Passo a palavra agora para a professora Melvina de Araújo, coordenadora do Programa de Pós-Graduação em Ciências Sociais.
Boa noite ou boa tarde. Estou muito feliz em ver todo mundo aqui, o teatro cheio. Eu queria dizer que é uma grande honra para nós, nós do Programa de Pós-Graduação em Ciências Sociais, receber a professora Patrícia Hill Collins. Essa honra é ainda acrescida porque ela nos escolheu. Ela foi convidada pela Fulbright, escolheu o nosso programa dentro do no quadro desse acordo Unpox Fulbright para vir para o Brasil. Então, isso muito nos honra. A Patrícia Hill Collins, a Patrícia aqui também é uma grande pessoa conhecida, mas a Patrícia Hill Collins tem um pouco mais de celebridade, ela é uma figura central para os estudos contemporâneos sobre desigualdade. E as perspectivas que ela desenvolve, ela vem ao encontro do eixo central das investigações que são desenvolvidas no nosso programa, que tem como foco um problema de fundo das sociedades contemporâneas, que são as diversas formas de desigualdade. E, embora o conceito de desigualdade seja usualmente associado à dimensão econômica da vida social, seu alcance é amplo, compreendendo a dimensão política, cultural e social em sentido abrangente, incluindo os diversos aspectos das diferenças sociais, como as relações raciais, étnicas, de gênero, religiosas e regionais. Na sociedade contemporânea, a desigualdade está na raiz dos sérios problemas sociais, tais como a injustiça, a segregação, a discriminação, o preconceito e a violência. A depender da situação estudada e da abordagem teórica, a desigualdade expressa-se por termos afins, como assimetria, diferença, diversidade, disparidade, distinção, com consequências e implicações decisivas para a produção de conhecimento pelos cientistas sociais. A estadia de Patrícia Hill Collins conosco certamente contribuirá para adensar, qualificar e fertilizar o debate interno ao PPGCS a partir de perspectivas advindas das discussões que vem desenvolvendo ao longo dos anos. Nós temos uma longa e densa agenda de discussões nos dias que seguem, e eu espero que essa agenda continue por muitos e muitos anos. Bom, esse evento é o primeiro dessa monta na EFELESH. E ele nos enche de esperança, de muita esperança, porque, apesar das agruras que a gente passou nos últimos 6 anos, da falta de pessoal, da falta de infraestrutura, nós conseguimos organizar a nossa escola para receber todos vocês aqui. Para que isso fosse possível, nós contamos com a colaboração de algumas instituições. Além da Unpox e da Fulbright, que já foram citadas aqui, nós também tivemos a ajuda da Fundação Frederic Ebert, da TID Setúbal e da Perseu Abramo. Tive a ajuda também dos colegas da Comissão de Gestão, de que fazem parte meu colega Bruno Comparato, que está aqui na mesa também, a Cíntia Sarte, Gabriela Ferreira, Henrique Amorim, Rogério Schlegel e Tatiana Landini. Eles foram fundamentais na elaboração do projeto e, enfim, na ajuda na gestão do programa. A professora Liana de Paula foi fundamental em todo o trabalho de divulgação, de preparo de uma série de coisas. Além disso, eu não vou citar todos os nomes, senão vou esquecer de alguém e podem ficar bravos comigo. Mas eu gostaria de chamar a atenção para muita gente especial, para toda a equipe acadêmica, administrativa, de manutenção e de limpeza que tornaram possível que a gente estivesse aqui hoje, nesse teatro que ainda está em reforma. Então, por tudo isso, eu gostaria de deixar aqui o meu muito obrigado a todos vocês.
Passo a palavra agora para o professor doutor Bruno Konder Comparato, diretor da EFELESH.
Boa tarde a todos, todas, todes. Vocês não imaginam a satisfação que eu tenho de ver esse teatro cheio. E, na última semana, os servidores todos da universidade, pelo menos deste campus, ficaram em função desse teatro. Então, a gente não tem como agradecer. Ontem, numa reunião, eu disse que todos mereciam uma medalha. E agora, não sei como é que eu vou fazer para arrumar essa medalha. Porque este é o primeiro evento no teatro depois da pandemia. Ele estava fechado. Esse teatro maravilhoso, vocês veem, fechado. Um pecado. E o nome do teatro, inclusive, é William Silva Moraes, é em homenagem a um estudante, é o primeiro de três estudantes deste campus que morreram de Covid. Morreram por causa da barbárie bolsonarista, com a cumplicidade do negacionismo científico, que não aceitou as vacinas quando foram oferecidas e postergou por mais alguns meses para poder comprar vacinas, e estima-se que isso resultou em pelo menos 400 mil mortes, dispensáveis, obviamente. E por isso nós demos o nome do teatro a este estudante, que era um estudante que adorava esse teatro. Ele fazia muitas coisas aqui, agitava cultura aqui nos arredores. Ele trabalhava na Secretaria de Cultura da Prefeitura de São Paulo, enfim. Então, é por isso que nós fizemos essa homenagem, para que ele e os outros que não estão mais aqui não sejam esquecidos, jamais. Então, é isso. E é por uma dessas coincidências maravilhosas do destino que ele é reaberto com a Patrícia Hill Collins, que tem tudo a ver com isso tudo que nós estamos vendo. Então, esse é meu agradecimento a vocês por virem aqui prestigiar este evento. É uma felicidade ver o teatro cheio. E agora estamos todos ansiosos para ouvir a Patrícia. Obrigado.
Por último, passo a palavra para o professor Dr. Fernando Attic, pró-reitor adjunto de pós-graduação e pesquisa.
Boa noite a todas, todos e todes. É um prazer enorme, como disse o professor Bruno, estar aqui nesse campus que é minha casa. Eu sou docente aqui no Departamento de História. E há muito tempo eu não via esse teatro tão permeado de vida. Então, é um prazer enorme perceber que o pensamento, a possibilidade de trocar ideias mobiliza ainda uma comunidade inteira adentrando a esse lugar, que, mais do que bonito, ele só tem sentido quando é permeado de vida. Então, eu faço aqui a minha saudação em nome da professora Rayane Assunção, nossa reitora pro tempore, e quando, dentre a escolha daqueles que viriam representar, eu já disse que eu viria, porque, além de ser minha casa, o assunto me interessa e eu tinha certeza que seria uma tarde, noite memorável para nós. Eu quero, então, em nome da reitoria, agradecer muito a adesão do PPGCS a esse programa, né, que teve a grata lembrança de fornecer aos programas de ciências sociais, através da Ampox e também da Fulbright, a possibilidade de que nós figurássemos entre a lista daqueles que poderiam ser escolhidos. Então, como disse a Melvina, é um privilégio imenso que nós passemos a fazer parte desse circuito internacional, numa escola que já está avançando para quase 2 décadas de funcionamento e inaugurando esse sistema de cooperação internacional mais potente a partir do Programa de Ciências Sociais, que é um programa importantíssimo para a nossa escola, que nos legou tantas coisas e que, tenho certeza, tem dado passos largos, já com o seu doutorado, com o seu mestrado, já de mais de 1 década. Então, para nós da reitoria, é um prazer enorme perceber como as ciências sociais estão dando uma contribuição enorme para o campo das humanidades. Então, como alguém que vem das humanidades, que é docente deste campus, eu só posso agradecer pela possibilidade de esta noite estar aqui para ouvir a professora Patrícia Hill Collins. Nossa universidade, ano que vem, completa 30 anos e nós temos aí começado uma sequência de comemorações. Essa ainda não está no calendário oficial, mas a gente pode requisitar que seja a primeira, porque o tema que será debatido nessas aulas públicas tem tudo a ver com o que é fazer a expansão de uma universidade que sai de uma profissão imperial, elitista, que era a medicina, e abarca todas as demais, que faz, inclusive, com que nós tenhamos voz, luta reconhecida e, sobretudo, a capilaridade dessa mistura que tem feito a IFELESC ser essa potência que tem se mostrado ser. Então, professor Bruno, parabéns, professora Melvina também. Eu desejo que esse programa tenha vida longa, que a Ampox continue dando passos largos e apoiando essas iniciativas. Então, muito obrigado, boa aula pública para nós.
Agora, nós faremos a composição da mesa da aula pública. Então, eu convido a professora Melvina a permanecer na mesa e aos demais membros a se sentarem na primeira fila da plateia. Quero aproveitar para registrar a presença da co-deputada estadual da bancada feminista do PSOL, Simone Nascimento. Também aproveito para lembrá-los que na mesa, ao lado da entrega dos equipamentos, vão ser disponibilizadas listas de presença. Então, pedi para todos assinarem na saída do evento. Além da professora Melvina, convido para compor a mesa Jaqueline Lima Santos, diretora de projetos de justiça racial e de gênero da Fundação Friedrich Ebert Brasil. Convido também nosso ilustre conferencista, Patrícia Hill Collins. Passo a palavra à professora Melvina Araújo, que irá conduzir os trabalhos.
Boa noite de novo. Então, eu vou fazer a apresentação aqui, vou apresentar nossa ilustre conferencista, a professora Patrícia Hill Collins. Eu poderia dizer que a Patrícia dispensa apresentações, mas eu não quero correr riscos, porque é o seguinte, uma vez, lá nos idos da minha juventude, o Darcy Ribeiro foi convidado para fazer uma conferência. E a pessoa que estava coordenando a mesa o apresentou assim. E eis aqui o professor Darcy Ribeiro, que dispensa apresentações. Darcy Ribeiro olhou para ela e disse, não dispenso, não, pode apresentar direitinho. Então, eu não vou correr esse risco, vou apresentar brevemente a nossa convidada, que atualmente é professora emérita da Universidade de Maryland. Ela é considerada, ao lado de Angela Davis e bell hooks, uma das mais influentes pesquisadoras do feminismo negro nos Estados Unidos. Patricia Hill Collins é autora de uma vasta obra, mas eu vou citar aqui só alguns livros que foram publicados no Brasil. Pensamento Feminista Negro, Conhecimento, Consciência e Política do Empoderamento, desculpa, está difícil isso aí, publicado em 2019. Bem Mais Que Ideias, A Interseccionalidade como Teoria Social Crítica, Política e Política Sexual Negra, os dois últimos publicados em 22. Patricia Hill Collins também foi a 100ª presidenta da Associação de Sociologia dos Estados Unidos e a primeira mulher afro-americana a ocupar esse posto. À minha esquerda, está aqui, eu estou honrada também pela presença de Jaqueline Lima Santos, que é doutora em antropologia, assim como eu, mas pela Unicamp, e Harvard Alumni Fellow. Ela atua como professora, pesquisadora e consultora nas áreas de equidade, raça, gênero, diversidade, educação, infância e juventude, história e cultura afro-brasileira e africana, cultura hip-hop e PALOP, os países africanos de língua oficial portuguesa. A Jaqueline é diretora de Justiça Racial e de Gênero da FES Brasil e consultora de Gueledés, Instituto da Mulher Negra. Co-coordena a coleção hip-hop em perspectiva da editora Perspectiva e a linha de pesquisa hip-hop em trânsito do SEMI-Unicamp. Bom, a Jaqueline vai, depois que acabar, que a Patrícia terminar a aula pública, a aula dela, a Jaqueline vai fazer algumas questões para dar um pontapé inicial no debate. Agora, sem mais delongas, eu passo a palavra para a nossa querida Patricia Hill Collins.
Obrigada. Um abraço para você. Eu amo viajar a Brasil porque é maravilhoso. Maravilhoso, não sei. Português é muito difícil para mim, mas eu tento to learn. So, I'll stand over here. All right. Meus amigos, sim. Tonight, well, that's hard to see, isn't it? All right. I have to give the talk in English, but I'm hoping soon to be able to give it in Portuguese for you. I am a student of Portuguese. I have a very long Duolingo streak. Booyah! The owl and I are learning, but it is a difficult language. Okay, so my talk tonight is why Black feminism? And what I'm doing tonight is one of four lectures that I will be giving here on this wonderful campus with its terrific energy. And these are the four. This is the first one, Why Black Feminism? This particular talk is foundational to all of my work. So what I'm doing with the talk tonight is talking about the main ideas of Black feminism that come out of Black feminism that inform the rest of my work. I also have listed the other dates and the titles of the talks I will be giving over this 4-week Fulbright visit. Intersectionality and political solidarity will be next week sometime. The idea of intersectionality comes from Black feminist thought for me, so I want to talk about that a bit more. And a theme that is not emphasized as much as I would like to see is the theme of political solidarity. May 30th, sharpening intersectionality's critical edge. Just because you have something doesn't mean it stays good or continues to do what you want it to do. This would be the situation with any progressive or radical set of ideas or political programs. So, intersectionality is now popular. This can be a good thing or this can be a problem. So I want to look at that particular issue. What is it like to do this work within the power relations that you're trying to upend? What does it mean to try and change power while you are still subject to that same power? Racism, sexism, homophobia, class exploitation. And finally, I'll finish up with the most recent book that I've just finished called Lethal Intersections, Intersectionality, Race, Gender, Lethal Intersections, Race, Gender, and Violence. So I have written a book on violence. So I'm happy to see people once again, because as you can imagine, writing a book on violence was very difficult during the pandemic when we had so many people who we lost before their time. So I'm gonna have to be a little more upbeat tonight because I'm bringing you down, I can see that. All right, everyone, perk up, come on, perk up. I'm doing this every time we do a slide change. All right. Okay. Keep going. Stop. Okay. This is an overview of tonight's talk. So you know the main themes that I will be discussing. Why Black feminism? First, I'm going to talk about the importance of thinking about Black feminism within a national context. I am not here to say Black feminism in the United States is the original or the best Black feminism at all. I'm here to say we are in a different point of time around how to think about this entire thing called Black feminism. So the first part of my talk, I will be talking about US Black feminism, right, in terms of its origins, very briefly, because you can read this now. The second part of my talk, I want to discuss the issue of Black feminism in diasporic decolonial context. I think it's really important that we begin to think about the multiple sites where one finds Black feminism and Black feminist thought and what they might have to do with one another and what they don't, what's the same and what's different. And I will finish up by saying a few things about Black feminism in a global human rights context. So you can think about this particular talk as freestanding all by itself. You don't have to hear any of the others. Or you can think about it as part of a puzzle piece. I'm looking at these four talks in terms of how they speak to one another. So you'll hear something today that you might hear in a future talk in a different way. Okay? Black feminism in national context. That is really hard to see, isn't it? Can you see my graphic? I've got a cool little graphic up there that's hard to see. What's happening with my graphic? I will describe it. What you've got is US Black feminism as local, and then a circle around it describing national context, and then a circle around it, that diasporic decolonial context that we have to pay attention to, and finally the broader human rights context. Now I'm coming at it this way, because usually people want to go immediately from the local, what's happening in my project, to the global. And I'm saying they're all points in between that we have to analyze and take into consideration. So the US context, one more. All right. I think it's really important in the US context to think about the fact that black people, and I can use the term, and you know the term black changes meaning depending on where you are, which is why I'm trying to say it this way, so we all are mindful of doing this. But for black people or African Americans in the US context, political domination occurred through slavery and captivity. So the word that I use isn't just slavery, because when you say slavery, people say, oh, that's over. That was a long time ago. Get over it. I never owned any slaves, so why are we talking about this? Can't we just all get along and have a racial democracy like they have in Brazil? Oh, I'm sorry, that just slipped out of me. I don't know where that came from, people. All right. But the whole notion of slavery in the US context is one of captivity. It's a metaphor for how you think about dominating people. The history, the social structure, and a metaphor. It begins with chattel slavery, which is important, but it continues on through Jim Crow racial segregation and apartheid in the US. It continues on through urban ghettoization. If you look at where a lot of poor black people are now, they're in cities, either urban poverty or rural poverty. And part of that structure is to hold that group politically powerless. This is what we're dealing with now in the United States with those who are in power, trying to take away voting rights, for example. So the whole notion of surviving captivity is really important in thinking about US black feminism. But the next piece is resisting captivity. And I'm using the term freedom struggle because this is the language that is often used among black activists and black intellectuals who are coming from a particular tradition. They are not talking about integration into society as it is. Oh, yay, thank you. Oh. They're actually talking about freedom, all right, as the core idea that informs the black experience in America, regardless of your class background or gender or anything. So the notion of freedom struggle is organized around decolonizing the body, the mind, and the spirit. Now, if you think about that, the body, you can enslave a body, you can colonize a body without colonizing the mind, the intellectual part, or the spirit, which is the soul and the creative part of a human being. So we're looking at a system of captivity that does that. Going more. Whoop, that's it, there we go. Right. So when I talk about anti-black racism in the US context, and I'm talking about this, by the way, because last time I checked, black women were a large portion of the black population. You can't just talk about black men and assume everything is generalizable to everyone. And I'm calling it anti-black racism in particular because racism is a bigger category than just something that targets black people, right? But there is a specific history of racism that is attached to blackness. So I'm using it that way. Domination, it aims to pervert the holistic relationship of body, spirit, and mind that might foster resistance. So if I can hold you captive and you can't run away, for example, or if I can convince you that you are supposed to be subordinate, that's your mind. If I can give you ideas that keep you down, so you watch yourself and you limit yourself, that's part of how domination works. That's the part where I work. I work with the mind, with the ideas, but also the spirit. If you can break a soul, if you've ever known anybody who just was so beaten down they didn't want to live, or they were just trying to escape on drugs, or on a variety of things. People who are in pain often have a pain of the spirit. And we don't talk about that enough, but that's part of how domination works. It's really perverting the holistic you. Now, do you remember being little, ever? All of you were little, right, I'm assuming. somewhere you were 2, 3 years old, 6 years old, something like that. Do you remember what kind of little kid you were like? You were probably mouthy. You talked a lot. You probably touched people. Oh, hi, stuff. You did inappropriate stuff. My daughter used to like dig in trash because she was just interested in what was in there. And I would be horrified. No, don't touch that. Oh, ew. Then she'd taste. Oh, stop that. All right. This whole point of we, at one point in our lives, had a holistic relationship between our body, our mind, and our spirit. And abomination gets all in there and messes with that. And here's what it does. It aims to dehumanize you, all right? So what anti-Black racism does in the U.S. is to convince people that Black people are not fully human. And this is part of the Western tradition. This dehumanization aims to kill the spirit, control the mind, and leave the body behind for domination and exploitation. So those of you who do class analysis, you can exploit people by turning them into bodies and units of labor for someone else's benefit. That's what exploitation is, you see. But it doesn't just, people don't go willingly to a place of being exploited or being dominated. This is where violence comes in. Violence is very important in relationships of domination. Have you ever seen a mother say, let's say a little child's about ready to do something wrong, or even a pet, and she'll make a noise like, uh-uh. she may not even say anything, and the kid stops, or the puppy stops. Don't do that thing that's wrong. You don't have to be violent to people. You have to have the threat that you will be. They have to be convinced that you have the power to do harm, if not kill them. This is something that underlines a lot of police interactions in the US. The notion of telling young Black people they have to obey or someone will get killed. You are aware of all the strings of killings of people by the police in the US. Yes? Those come from that. Violence and the threat of death as technologies of domination. Next. All right, so why Black feminism exists? One more. What we have here is the existential questions of captivity, violence, and death take specific forms for African American women, men, queer people, and youth. And there's often violence involved in those specialized gendered sexual relationships. So Black women have said, our participation in this freedom struggle stems from our special experiences as Black women. Resisting anti-Black racism requires analyses and actions that take gender and sexuality into account. Now, what I have up here are two pictures, if you can see the graphics. And these both happened in the last 4 to 5 years in the US. And they both involve adolescent girls, Black girls who are teenagers, who you would think would be safe going to a pool party in a suburb in Texas. I think it was Texas. And because this little girl did not listen to the police, apparently, they wrestled her to the ground and manhandled her and treated her very badly. Now, they would not do that to a little white girl. I'm just letting you know. So the whole notion of the control of the body, the control of Black women's bodies, and the way Black women are dealt with is part of this larger system and part of this larger freedom struggle. The graphic on the bottom is a police officer who basically attacked a child who's in school. You would think you'd be safe in your school. You would not want to think that the police who are there to protect you are in fact going to harm you when you're trying to get an education. We have video because we have cell phones now. We can photograph stuff and upload it. These are all the microaggressions that may not have been known in the past that now can travel far beyond the situations where they occurred.
Both of these have traveled. I put these graphics up to convince you. When we talk about captivity, domination, violence, bodily integrity, we are not just talking about Black men, nor are we talking about ungendered Black people, that there are specific histories for Black women. Keep going, keep going, keep going. This is a, and here I just want to talk very briefly, the then and the now, about why Black feminism. Well, Black feminism exists to fight violence. It exists to fight dehumanization. It exists to fight domination, this freedom struggle. Now, when I say dehumanization in the middle, you'll notice that Black women have for some time advanced what I would call an intersectional analysis of race, gender, and sexuality. Many people seem to think that Black feminism sprang out, finished, when, let me just pick somebody, as wonderful as she is, when Angela Davis said, "What about race, class, and gender?" But she was really following the path that was forged by many Black women before who never rose to prominence. Now, Ida Wells Barnett did rise to prominence because she took a stand against lynching. And she was quite vocal about it. She was a journalist. And she spoke out about it, and she dared to say what people of those times were afraid to say. So we would call it, she would not have called herself a feminist. She might not have called herself Black. She would not have used the word intersectional. But if you read her work, this is exactly what she's talking about. There is a straight line, and obviously I'm leaving a lot out. This is just to hit some highlights, because this is a relatively short talk, between resisting anti-Black racism of the past and now. And I call your attention to Black Lives Matter. The same bullet points show up in terms of Black women's involvement in Black Lives Matter today. Violence after Trayvon Martin's death in 2014 and the aftermath of that. You see down at the bottom, Patrice Cullors, Alicia Garza, and Opal Tometi, or Tometi, I believe, who are the three Black women who started the hashtag Black Lives Matter, because they were so outraged at yet another child who was killed, right? And there was no justice for that child in the criminal justice system. And apparently enough people, and it was the violence. Usually the violence is the precipitating incident. When you see violence against yourself or your child or someone you love, and you know it's wrong. So that was just one step too many. So also, in this particular movement, the dehumanization that highlights the humanity of Black youth, and youth come in all kinds of flavors. So if you're gonna protect one Black child, you have to protect every Black child. You can't protect a straight child more than a queer child or a gay child. Domination. Black feminist analysis and activism was informed by intersectionality. I'll say a bit more about that in future talks. But what I basically want to say about the Black Lives Matter movement is how much they pulled Black feminism into mainstream Black political activism. So it's a really interesting period of time in the US that the ideas of many Black women and queer folk that were not in the center of Black political activism are now central to Black Lives Matter, which is not just US, but is also global. Next. How are you doing out there? Is this too serious? Can you be serious this time at night, or what's up with this? Are you all doing okay? Oh, look at you over there. What is on your head? I love your hair. You know who I'm talking about, right? Yes, you. Raise your hand, stand up. Can they look at your hair? Just stand, look at your hair, look at that. Okay, fine, thank you. I got distracted. I always have to stop and comment on something like, ooh, look at that hair, that was amazing. Sorry. Hello, I'm Dr. Collins, and I'm here to talk with you about why Black feminism. Are we ready? No, I'm just kidding. But I just want to say, if you look at just the footage from the Black Lives Matter movement, it really has pulled out all kinds of people under the banner for me of freedom struggle. Great. So I'm going to, in the interest of time, not dwell on this. I want to keep going a little further and get into the second part of my talk soon. And this would be my favorite graphic, just to say a word about it. In many ways, this picture is real. It's an iconic picture of a Black woman who was nurse, who was so disturbed by the killing, I believe it was Alton Sterling, that she said she had to do something. So she just went to a Black Lives Matter movement demonstration and went out and confronted the police. You can see the police. This is the power of the state. This is the power of domination. This is how people come at you, even though they're not always dressed like this. This is what power looks like, all right? When the violence has not happened, but it's the threat of violence that keeps the domination in place. And she confronts this wearing a sundress and looking at them like, you're not scaring me, because this whole thing is bigger than you and me. So in many ways, this is the spirit of Black feminism. And this is a woman who probably wouldn't call herself a feminist. She may not. I mean, but that's not the point. For me, the point is the bigger ideas here. All right, let's move on. So, core ideas, keep going, of Black feminism that emerged over time and through this freedom struggle. One core idea is that social justice is the ethical core of Black feminism. That's the freedom struggle. This is a struggle, this is an experience, this is a Black feminism that has an ethical core. Now, so much of what happens in the US does not have an ethical core anymore. It is very much about other things than doing the right thing. And you know how hard it is to do the right thing on a daily basis, and you're tested. But social justice is the ethical core of Black feminism, because it comes out of a freedom struggle where you will never be free unless there is social justice. You can't free yourself as an individual and say, well, the rest of you, good luck. It doesn't work that way, right? Intersectionality is the analytical framework, and I'll talk about that in future sessions, but that's the notion that you can't get free, I can't get free without you. I can't be a free Black woman if you're an impoverished, downtrodden Black woman. I can't be free no matter how rich I am, because somebody, if there's a poor Black person, that is still, I'm implicated in that in terms of how I will be treated. So the notion of an intersectional framework is quite important in thinking about these categories of race and class and gender and sexuality. Flexible political solidarity, I'll be talking about in a future talk, but this is a way of saying you must be in coalition with people. It's not a question of the big tsupuba leader. The notion of networking among many individuals and many groups is important. But the bottom line of any Black feminist program, no matter how downtrodden you are, is hope as the belief that change is possible. If you did not believe that change is possible, why would you try? And that's the whole spirit part of it. The people who have lost hope, it's somehow gotten into their bodies. Now, when you look at Black, the whole history of Black women who've been involved in contributing to Black feminism, named and unnamed, they have been hopeful. Every time a woman says to her child, it didn't happen for me, it's not going to happen for me ever, but it might happen for you. If you study, if you go to school, if you whatever. So hope is a really important idea when you're looking at intergenerational political struggle. Next slide. All right, well, it's better here, but it's not still not great, my graphic. But it's okay. I can live without my graphic if you can live without it. I want to move on now to Black feminism in diasporic decolonial context, and I want to broaden that lens beyond the local to the broader. Oh, look at this. This is so interesting. Okay, sorry. I got distracted because you can put that back up. The next one is fine. I must have waved my hand randomly and they changed the slide. All right, but anyhow, the notion of Black feminist projects in diasporic decolonial context. I've talked about one Black feminism in the US that is tied to the history of the US. What about other Black feminist projects that may or may not call themselves Black feminism? In the same way, and they are everywhere. And I'm working with the national context. I started with US, but of course the obvious question would be, what about Black feminism in Brazil, the Brazilian national context, or Black feminism in Cuba, the Afro-Cuban context, or Black feminism in South Africa, which has a very different history, but similar issues around freedom struggle, similar issues around domination, around dehumanization, around violence. So looking at these other projects, not from the lens of looking in, but asking what has been the history building up in each of these places, grappling with these same issues. You still with me? Let me just wait for a minute. Translate. Okay. Are you still with me? Okay. This translation is a challenge for me, particularly tonight. I just got off the plane yesterday and I'm sort of like, where am I? Oh, São Paulo, sim, eu estou em São Paulo, em Brasil. Eu acho, mas acerto, etc. Okay. It's kind of like that for me. So be kind to me tonight, all right? Let me see if you look kind. I'll have that over here. You look pretty friendly. Yes, right there. Yes, I'm looking right at you. No, not you, but you look friendly too. That's okay. There's a friendly row right up in there somewhere. All right. And I don't know about the people in the back row. You always have to wonder about the people on the back row. Like this person right on, you're not on the back row. There is somebody behind you in the corner who I think is asleep. Are you asleep? Could you raise your hand, please? You, nope, behind you. Turn around, you, yes. Were you sleeping? Were you thinking? Okay, you're thinking. You hear what I said about the people in the back row? Look how long it took me to get that person's attention. Oi. All right, let me keep going. All right, so anyhow, Black freedom struggle, this is so you're reminded that this is a common struggle diasporically. I mean, there is the political framework of decolonization. All of these various colonial powers, one of which is Portuguese, one is Spanish, one is British, one is French, one is, who did I forget? Oh gosh, it's somebody else. There's so many, those are the major ones. Oh, yes, the British, I got them already. They got everybody, so what, maybe that's why I keep saying them over and over again, all right. But the question of the same freedom struggle, but with different systems, right? So the whole notion of decolonizing the body, mind, and spirit, same thing, all right? Wherever you go, when you want to oppress people, you do that. That's what you have to do. Nurturing the spirit, excuse me. What Black freedom struggle does is resist decolonizing the bond, all of that. What it does is nurturing the spirit by rejecting anti-Blackness and creating self-definitions that value Black humanity. And what Black freedom struggle does is a body politics that defends the integrity of Black bodies and Black life. And this is very much at the center of Black feminism as well. Am I talking too fast? Should I slow down? Am I okay? Because, you know, I just like to just get into my material here, and I just sort of want to go with the flow. But I forget, you know, I can't do spoken word and all that stuff and blah, 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 blah. Okay, sorry. Let's move on to the next slide. Thank you. We are in Brazil. And I will be the first to tell you that I don't know as much as I need to know or want to know about Black feminism in Brazil. But I think this is a story that is being written aggressively by many people. And Laila Gonzalez, if I'm saying this even close to it, was so central to getting the ideas out here in Brazil. The issue has been having things not being translated so they could travel. But we are in a very different period of time now where her ideas Many people know about her ideas, about her work, about her experiences, about her activism, about the Black women's organizations here in Brazil that draw inspiration from her. That you have a very powerful figure here of Black feminism. So there's no reason why US Black feminism should be at the center. What should be happening is developing national stories about Black feminism, of what Black women are doing in a variety of national contexts to grapple with these core questions. So I've brought the core questions to you and one particular story about it. But this is a quote. I don't know if I want to really remember. I can read the quote too if you can't see it. Would you like me to read this quote? This is current. This is from current research that's being done on her. The impact of Gonzalez's work as an activist and intellectual. You hear that? An activist and an intellectual. You don't have to be just one or just the other. In fact, most people are not. We are both intellectual activists. The impact of Gonzalez's work as an activist and intellectual can be seen in the celebration of her life, scholarship, and political work. Wow, that's really hard to do. And here's a person who managed to get a doctorate in Brazil before all these universities that you now have, like this one. And also managed to be an activist and produce scholarship. It's very impressive. She is still remembered by a generation of scholars and activists who worked alongside her in the national Black movement, and those who forged solidarity with that struggle from Black communities around the world. Her ideas are central to what I'm talking about tonight. And if my Portuguese were better, I would be delivering this part of the lecture in Portuguese. But we'll save that for another day. We'll have to invite me back. No, another day. Let's move on. Oh! Here is an individual who you know, so you don't need me to say anything much, except to point out how special this person. I never met Marielle Franco. That's one of my great regrets, that I never had an opportunity to do that. 3 months before I did the Fulbright in Rio, in 2017, I believe it was. I was there in June. 3 months before was when she was killed. And when I met Black women who were so distraught and upset, they couldn't even talk about it. It was too fresh in terms of that kind of loss. So I do not want to make light of anyone's life, but I am very happy to see that Marielle Franco, her ideas persist. They have not gone away. In fact, I think they have grown, and she's really a figure that linked the local with the global. And so much of my understanding of her work is the opposition to violence in all of its forms. Whether it's violence in the home, violence on the street, or violence of the police in terms of how favelas are policed. She spoke up and she paid a price. But we don't want to just be seduced by the power of the march. What I really like about learning more about her was to recognize how she was trying to use her position on Rio Council to affect a range of issues that that council was dealing with. So sometimes you have people who are both front stage, but many people who are institutional workers as well. And they don't get the clapping and the praise and all that. They may not even be named, but they're so, and this is the face of Black feminism in a lot of ways in Brazil. So, well, apparently you all have heard of Marielle Franco, huh? And some of you can help me learn more while I'm here. I'll be here for a month, and I'm more than happy to learn as much as I possibly can about Black feminism in Brazil. But I think it's important for all of us to push beyond our national context. And I'm trying to push beyond my national context of the United States, which comes with benefits and blinders, and to learn the national context of Brazil, which is really similar to the US, but completely different. So it's really an interesting connection between the US and Brazil. Let's keep going. We're never going to finish this talk if I don't pick up the pace. Oh, well. Okay. As I was pulling out person after person for this talk, it got late and I ran out of time, but I said, I have so much admiration for Conceição Evaristo because she's someone who I've actually met and she should have gotten that award, you know? But her book is so crucial. How do I say this? Poncia? Where are you? Just say the whole thing for me, please. Poncia e Vicencio. Close? Right. I'm working on my pronunciation. You can correct me for the next month. My feelings will not be hurt. All right. But this is an amazing book. And it's a book of fiction. And I wanted to bring this in because many people think that politics is all about marches in the street and just, you know, that kind of image. And that's what Black feminism is all about. But there's this whole other piece of people who are working on the mind and the spirit through fiction, through art, through drama, through dance, through a variety of other means. That's where you find the politics, especially when it is dangerous to do it in public. You've just had an election, so you have yet another administration, and things are different now. So sometimes it's safer to do this work, and other times it's not as safe. But the issue is you continue to do the work regardless, because it's part of a freedom struggle, the freedom of an individual and of people. I love this picture, too. Okay, I'm sorry, I got all wrapped up in this slide. Let's just do one more and then we're just gonna move on here with this Black Brazilian, oh, this one, yes. Black Brazilian feminism. This is a mural. Marielle Franco, Leila Gonzalez, and Jamila Ribeiro, who I did not have a slide. I really liked Jamila. She has a slide in there, but it's not finished. But what I like is this is an artist, Ira Ocrespo, who says 2 years after the death of Marielle Franco, I believe this is in Rio, in the Lapa district, I think. And what I really like about this mural, if you look, the street artists are writing history on everything. It's not just that the politics is in the classroom or the kinds of books that I write or the kinds of speeches that people give. The artists are actually writing on the physical environment and on physical space. And they're doing it in ways to memorialize people or to remember ideas or to protest. This one pulls together the lineage or the connections between three different people who are all both part of, excuse me, all part of Brazilian, Black Brazilian feminism. So, these books are being written as we speak, as I speak. There's so much that's going on, and I encourage you to teach me. That's what I'm looking for. This is why I'm learning Portuguese, so I can read your stuff, all right? That's what I would say to you. So now, let's move on. So here's the challenge for everybody who's involved in a local project. I've just talked about two. If I were giving this talk in South Africa, And I were thinking about the connections between Brazilian black feminism and black feminism in South Africa, or black British feminism. How would this talk be the same and different? So here's the challenge: building political solidarity among heterogeneous black feminist projects. Building political solidarity among projects. The growing significance of national context. We are now much more sensitive to what it means to be in a particular national context. You can't just say to somebody, go free yourself. It doesn't work that way. Because these categories of race and gender and class are all controlled through national laws and regulations. So the national context is quite significant. Everybody wants to go to the global. Not quite yet. We have to work our way through the national. What is the view of black feminism from within each national context? I'm not talking top down, me coming in and studying. So the old fashioned, please forgive me, Melvina, the old fashioned anthropology. I'm talking about the bottom up, self-defined work that is people defining their own realities and why they're doing it that way. And this is what these black feminist projects and histories do. That's what they have. And what dialogues exist and or can be developed among multiple black feminist projects. So that's where we are now. We're in a world where we have the communications technologies to learn about each other's histories, right? And so the why of why black feminism exists in one place differs from one place to, well, the why is the same, but it differs. The project itself differs. Okay, let's move on. Now I'm gonna speed through the end of my talk so that we have questions and answers. Points of connection. I'm gonna speed through. I'm gonna put this in a future talk. I'm speeding. Let's go. Okay. Oh, but I do wanna say this, because this is where we're going. So tools for black diasporic feminism. The first thing is to recognize heterogeneity. Not all people are the same. Not all black feminisms are the same. There is no one big major black feminism. There are multiple projects that can learn from one another. The second, using intersectionality as an analytical tool to build that political solidarity. That's for a future talk. But I'm gonna foreshadow it here because I think we have a language that will help address this issue of how do we organize now? Because intersectionality is already within so many black feminist projects. So why would we not say, let's use this tool, whatever we call it. And coalition politics. I think it's very important now to focus on not just forms of solidarity where we all agree with one another, and then we throw people out who disagree. But coalitions, placing multiple projects in dialogue. Multiple projects in dialogue with one another. This is the moment to really learn from each other's victories and mistakes, to learn from each other's problems and strategies that were successful. This is a very perilous moment globally. All right, so now I'm gonna move on. Let's see, we have part three. And I wanna say a word or two about this broader context. Because notice I didn't get to, we can just move on to the next one as well in the interest of time. And this, I'm gonna leave this up for a minute because this is how I'm initially framing the global human rights context. I'm not framing it as a generic human. There's such a thing as a generic human who has rights. I have carefully in this talk talked about categories of people who are certainly human, but who are treated differently because of categories of power, race, class, gender, sexuality. National context is what I've emphasized. I've also emphasized resistance to that particular situation. So the global human rights context provides an overarching ethical framework. It provides a framework for the kinds of conversations and coalitions that can happen. And that overarching framework of going from the local to the global has social issues that should concern everybody. And I've listed a few: food, safety, housing, education, environment, dignity. But you can't get to the global from the local without going through the middle. And this is what a lot of people would like to do. They want to just go, let's have an environmental movement where we're all equal and we're for the earth and against coal, that kind of thing. There are all these things in between that have to be taken account of. So transnational feminism is a very important discourse and politics, political project, for multiple projects that call themselves feminists. Black feminism is not the only feminist project. In the US, there is Chicana feminism. Now, Latinas, have a distinctive history with all of this. So, or indigenous people, when we talk about race, now that becomes really interesting in terms of what does that mean from one national context to the next. So there's a global, but there's a specific. So the whole notion of anti-racism, and I'm conflating these two because I'm getting tired, so I have to wrap this talk up while I can still talk. All right. We have transnational feminism, where resisting heteropatriarchy takes very different forms and requires coalitions. You cannot be in coalition with someone that does not understand your experience, who does not want to learn your experience, and who wants to subordinate you to their experience, especially if it's in a project of resistance. Not gonna work. Anti-racism, same thing. Racism, notice earlier on I said anti-black racism, but racism takes many forms across many national contexts. So the solution from some of my colleagues, let's just abolish the word race. And racism will go away with that. We won't have racism anymore because we won't be talking about race. Well, it sounds a little, why would you do that? So why would we just say, let's just abolish men and women. Let's stop talking about gender. And we won't have any more problems. Working through the history is crucial. And that's the hard work of political coalitions. So what I'm saying here is that it's a big world, and there are many people who are struggling to be free or to live in a safe environment or for social justice. So there's plenty of space. But the issue is to not lose your way because there's so many others struggling. So for me, Black feminism is in a really interesting moment. It provides a foundation and links to all of these other projects. But it has to remember to continue to carry itself forward. You see, and I'm going to finish up. So I'm just going to keep going. We're coming back. Oh, here's another project. Well, I'll just say this. No, I'm not going to say this. How are you all doing? You're doing okay? Look at you. You're all comfy, and I'm up here working. She's just lying back in her chair, and she's saying, I'm doing well. Yeah, you know, what I really want to say here is, can you go back to the prior slide? I think I got my second wind. Can you go backwards? Is this good? We can do this? No, go backwards. Oh, that went forward. Okay. Okay, we went forward. That's all right, Pigbill. We'll just go forward. All right. Keep going. Okay. Because this really is where I want to pause and end. The slide before was of a, I was bringing in an example of a Black feminist project in the Democratic Republic of Congo. All right, so the question of really beginning to start look globally for multiple feminist projects or multiple Black women's projects that don't necessarily come through the UN or through the global human rights framework, but that are there nonetheless. It's almost looking for something that you didn't think was there, and then you get there and you realize it's really here, even under a situation where you wouldn't expect to see it. I'll come back to that at a future date. But I want to finish with these core ideas. Remaining critical, a core challenge for our time. And I just want to finish up with Black feminist politics as comprehensive, flexible, and strategic. Black feminist politics as flexible, comprehensive, and strategic. So in other words, it's all in the project that you're currently working on. That's how I feel about Black feminism. It's just all in there. It's comprehensive, but it's outward looking. It's flexible. It's very strategic about what you learn and what you don't learn, how it reveals itself. It's grounded in hope. Change is possible, both now and in the future. Why do it if there's no hope? Those of you who people think are apolitical because you're not talking politics, no, you could be quite political by how you're dealing with other people in nurturing them, keeping them alive, keeping them moving forward. Social justice, commitment to ethical principles and to one another, and intersectionality, an analytical framework that can ground these kinds of ideas because it comes from these kinds of projects. This is what you find in Black feminism. So I'm going to stop here rather than go any further. And we're just going to pause here and say, thank you. Obrigada. Now, just imagine the talk I could have given if I wasn't tired. And if I gave it in Portuguese. Oh, yeah. I'm coming for you, people. I'm coming for you.
Jaqueline, você sabe como funciona isso?
O quê?
Essa coisa.
Você tem que colocar no canal.
Qual que é o canal?
Só um minutinho, gente.
Alguém sabe qual o canal que está em inglês?
Três. O dela já está.
Pode falar.
Tá. Tá certinho.
Tá certo. Alguém pode acender a luz, por favor? Eu então passo a palavra, quer dizer, antes de qualquer coisa.
Okay.
Antes de qualquer coisa, eu quero agradecer a Patrícia pela maravilhosa aula que nos concedeu. E passo a palavra para a Jaqueline, que vai fazer alguns comentários.
Boa noite a todas as pessoas. Tarefa difícil, a professora Melvina me deu, né, de fazer esses comentários, mas vamos lá. Primeiro, eu queria agradecer a professora Patrícia por essa belíssima aula, né, que eu acho que ajuda a gente a organizar ideias sobre o feminismo negro de um ponto de vista transnacional, né, e também traz conceitos que são importantes para esse momento em que o Brasil vive a reconstrução de políticas de enfrentamento às desigualdades, né? Porque o feminismo negro, ele não só, como bem disse a professora, ele não só oferece ferramentas analíticas, mas ele traz um senso de justiça social. Logo no início da fala da professora, quando ela começa a falar do feminismo negro dentro das fronteiras nacionais, eu já pensava muito em Lélia Gonzalez, porque eu conseguia ver muitas similaridades com aquilo que ela faz. Quando a gente se debruça no texto da Lélia Gonzalez sobre o afrofeminismo latino-americano, por exemplo, né, ela fala sobre dominação, desumanização e violência. Mas como que a dominação, né, produz um processo de desumanização que torna o corpo de mulheres negras, e aí pensando gênero e raça, num alvo potencial de violência. Só que eu acho que uma coisa que ficou na minha cabeça enquanto a professora falava, quando a gente pensa dominação, desumanização e violência, que eu acho que a violência entra na chave da luta por direitos fundamentais, né? Tem esse tripé de dominação, desumanização e violência, mas, quando a gente olha para os movimentos que estão lutando pelos direitos fundamentais no Brasil, esses movimentos, eles são liderados por mulheres negras. Quando a gente olha para o movimento das mães crecheiras, quando a gente olha para os movimentos de moradia, quando a gente olha para os movimentos de familiares vítimas de violência. Então, a violência entra nessa chave de como que esse feminismo negro brasileiro luta pelos direitos fundamentais, né? E se tem uma coisa que esse feminismo negro ele tem como central, e que a professora traz, é a esperança e o espírito, né, o objetivo de alcançar a justiça social, porque são pessoas que estão lutando por direitos fundamentais a partir de articulações coletivas para alcançar a justiça social e que, no meio das ausências e da precariedade de territórios onde não tem nada, né, essas pessoas têm esperança de mudança. Então, ao pensar, né, esses três conceitos, dominação, desumanização e violência, eu fui entendendo, né, a chave que a professora traz, que different histories but similar issues. É aí que a gente se encontra em nível da diáspora. Mas eu quero trazer uma questão que é uma provocação para a universidade brasileira e como conceito de interseccionalidade entra na universidade brasileira e também as produções do feminismo negro e das mulheres negras. Tem um texto da professora que foi traduzido, eu acho que um dos primeiros traduzidos que foi traduzido pela Bianca Santana, uma feminista negra brasileira também, que se chama Se Perdeu na Tradução, Feminismo Negro, Interseccionalidade e Política Emancipatória, no qual a professora ela diz o seguinte: a promessa inicial do feminismo negro e a ideia de interseccionalidade que a acompanhou consistia em promover políticas emancipatórias para essas pessoas que aspiravam à construção de uma sociedade mais justa. E, ao pensar essa ideia, é aqui que se encontra a provocação de que a universidade, a academia, ela se perdeu na tradução das produções do feminismo negro, das produções das mulheres negras, da ideia de interseccionalidade como ferramenta analítica. Porque a professora ela demonstra que a ideia de interseccionalidade ela foi construída a partir dos movimentos sociais de mulheres de cor, né, women of color, que buscavam colocar em debate as suas particularidades como pontos necessários para que a justiça social se efetivasse para todas as pessoas. Então, antes desse conceito ganhar popularidade, e ele ganha aqui no Brasil também, no ambiente acadêmico, ele já vinha sendo desenhado a partir da praxis, né, que a professora usa, da luta política de mulheres não hegemônicas. Então, Desse modo, houve um processo acadêmico de separação da concepção de interseccionalidade dos movimentos sociais que foram responsáveis pela sua construção, ao isolar, quando a universidade isola essa categoria analítica daquilo que esteve presente nos caminhos que possibilitaram a criação da interseccionalidade, que é a junção do conhecimento emancipatório com a política emancipatória. Então, a universidade não está pensando ainda essa política emancipatória. Então, quando a gente toma o conceito de interseccionalidade, como a professora aponta, nós devemos buscar seus fundamentos nas construções iniciais dos movimentos de mulheres negras, que pretendiam ir além da legitimação acadêmica do conceito, mas empreender uma praxis política de transformação social. Então, nesse sentido, professora, a minha pergunta é a seguinte: o que que a universidade brasileira, hoje mais diversa, mas não suficiente, deve fazer para não se perder nessa tradução? Para não se apropriar dos conceitos de mulheres negras sem a noção de justiça social. Como que a nossa universidade ela se posiciona diante das desigualdades que ela narra, não apenas como um fenômeno retórico, mas como ela se posiciona a favor da justiça social? É isso.
Muito obrigada, Jaqueline.
It sounds like what's happening here is what has happened in the United States. In the United States, we had a good 20 years of working on intersectionality without it being discovered. And that allows you to build the kinds of programs and institutions or initiatives that you want. So the term intersectionality was not struggled over until there was the perception that it was incredibly powerful. So when you find yourself in a struggle for something that used to be like, oh, it's just black women doing it, that's the whole notion of you can be held captive, put off in the corner, and you know, separated out and say, well, that's just you saying that. When you realize that these ideas are coming from deep in the bones of not just black women, but many other struggles, I didn't talk enough about that at the end of the conversation. Black women have been very vocal about this and have exerted leadership around this, in part because when you start from a situation where you're not seen as human, you can either capitulate or the only way to go is forward and to fight. And fighting can take many different forms, as I've commented on here. Now, for universities seem like, I'm going to give an example that was told to me years ago by a university administrator. And she worked at a very black woman who worked at a very prestigious university in the United States. And she said, you know, have you ever seen an egg? And an egg looks pretty firm, like you can't get in. It has a hard shell. But when you look at an egg close up, you see all the cracks in that egg. And she said, what you need to do to get things done is to work every single crack that you can find in that egg. And that is very much a metaphor for an institution. Each institution is unique. It may appear to be like it's all the same as all the others, but each institution and college or university is a constellation of people, positions, rules, and processes. Those are all the places where you can find the cracks. And if you're fortunate enough to capture some of the positions of authority, you don't have to walk around saying, I'm for black women, I'm for intersectionality, I'm for this. You might actually get more done by not saying that and just doing it. And this is really what is so powerful about one committed person, wherever they may be.
Sometimes it's the quiet one, sometimes it's the noisy one, sometimes it's a group, sometimes the rules changed and you didn't quite know how they happened, how that happened. So power, when it is exercised smoothly, you don't see it happen. It's very much like the metaphor I gave of the threat of violence is what keeps people in their place. If you really had to push back and say, make us do every single thing you want us to do, cooperation is crucial in situations of domination and oppression. So as knowledge workers, everything that we do to disrupt a situation that is unfair and to facilitate, it could be we criticize in many, many ways, or to, I love the whole idea of capturing positions of power. So you can change things from the top down and the bottom up at the same time through a very interesting coalition. And Black women are uniquely positioned to do that. So in many ways, the meetings that need to occur are the private meetings where people strategize what they want, what kinds of changes you want to see at University X or College Y, and what are the best ways to work the cracks? Who's the best person to go first or second or third? So to me, there are no, when it comes to on the ground changes in universities, that's what I'm talking about now. But if it's a question of establishing a policy environment that supports you as you do that, this is why it's very important to have people who are working the cracks elsewhere, in the court system, in the legislative system, in the media, very powerful in terms of changing the dynamics of how we see things. Notice how I added the artists in here. People don't normally think of artists as sort of the big political leaders of our times, but they are the ones who change the consciousness of people by presenting other possibilities, like this whole movement of Afrofuturism that says we can imagine a different future than the one we're in now. Now, how do you control that? I mean, how do you actually say, don't imagine, unthink that thought, right? Unhear that word. You didn't see that picture. Marielle Franco never existed. So the effort will be to silence and suppress. But as long as there is a continuation of this, I have enough confidence that people will, they're smart enough to figure out how to bring about change in institutions, even though those institutions are extremely difficult to change. They weren't always there, and they certainly weren't always there in that way. I mean, I live in a country where my ancestors were enslaved, illiterate, couldn't own themselves, let alone their own children. So, I mean, that's a pretty interesting place to start from. You're not gonna ever convince me that nothing can be done. Those people, nothing can be done. Oh no, you'll never convince me of that. Because in many ways, that is to insult my friends and relatives and ancestors. So I'm not gonna be first in line, you know, waving my degree and saying, nothing can be done, not at all. You can always find something. So I've just talked briefly here about strategic possibilities with universities based on my lengthy experience of being in them and seeing them from many, many different roles, students, faculty, graduate students, administrators, staff support people, secretaries, librarians, people who clean the offices. There's a variety of people, maintenance people, who all have a stake in the same institution, but not the same stake. That's how I look at it. Lots of cracks.
Agora nós podemos abrir para algumas questões do público. Eu só pediria que quem quiser fazer perguntas viesse até aqui, porque nós só temos um microfone, só um que funciona na escola, gente, é isso. Então, É que senão eu vou ter que ficar indo e voltando com o microfone, então é melhor que venha até aqui. Aqui?
Que quem quiser fazer pergunta, pode fazer uma fila aqui, ó. Aí, em algum momento, a gente...
Posso começar? Ai, que nervoso. Bom, boa noite. Primeiramente, queria muito agradecer, né, por essa aula. Eu sou cubana e eu fiz meu doutorado aqui na Universidade Federal de Santa Catarina. Eu sei o conceito de matriz de dominação para pesquisar políticas públicas de saúde cubanas, né? E uma das perguntas da Van, que eu estava falando disso hoje, por acaso, né, numa aula na USP, foi por que eu estava usando feministas negras do norte global para lidar com um contexto do sul global como Cuba, né? E por que eu estava usando feministas negras estadunidenses? E assim, uma das minhas elaborações diante dessa pergunta foi responder que, bom, que mesmo no norte global a gente poderia encontrar muito sul, num sentido mais político, antes que geográfico, e que, de fato, a saúde trans e a saúde reprodutiva, que foram objetos da minha pesquisa, essas políticas públicas de saúde tinham tudo a ver com justiça social. Então, eu fiquei muito feliz quando hoje eu vi nos slides, né, esses projetos feministas negros no contexto diaspórico, vi ali afro-cubanas. Então, assim, só agradecer por essa aula e, assim, enfim, eterna gratidão. Estou muito, muito feliz e emocionada justamente por essa possibilidade de poder ter tido a chance de escutar essa aula. Muito obrigada.
Just a quick follow-up comment. I don't need to hear myself. Yeah, there we go. I got confused for a minute. Where'd you go? Where'd you go? There you are. Okay. I just want to comment back because the whole notion of thinking about the political South, I hadn't heard anyone describe it quite that way. But that's exactly where I'm going with my work right now. I'm working on youth. And there are all these people who are working on youth in the global South. And I've been making the case that you have the global South in the global North. This is the diasporic argument that I'm beginning to make here, or the decolonial argument. So I'm really happy to hear what you said, because I think this is the next direction. This is where we need to go next. And as for the people who said to you, why are you using from the global North? Because you use everything that speaks to your project, regardless of who said it or where it comes from, and you leave the rest behind. You don't have to take everything, but you take what's important. And when people want to try and take away something that you think is powerful because it's threatening to them, then it's really interesting to think, why is that so threatening to that person who I thought was my friend? That's when it's hardest to see. So I thank you very much, because this is affirmation for me. You all must realize that this is really difficult work to do and to sustain over time and to continue to question yourself constantly about where you're taking it next. But there's a generational shift going on right now that is really interesting globally. So I'm not looking to all the old people ahead of me or even all the old people around me. I'm really looking to what's happening to youth politically, because I think there's some interesting stuff going on around those social issues, health being one of them, and bodily integrity certainly being another for them.
Olá, boa noite. Primeiro, meu nome é Shirley, estudo aqui filosofia na Unifesp. É um prazer estar aqui e receber você. Espero que a sua estadia seja ótima e muito obrigada pelas aulas. Bom, o que eu queria perguntar, depois dessa excelente exposição que você fez, é como você encara os movimentos conservadores de extrema-direita que a gente está vendo no mundo, está vendo com muita força nos Estados Unidos, mas também aqui no Brasil, um crescimento do neonazismo e de uma série de políticas ligadas à masculinidade, masculinismo, e de um retrocesso em relação aos direitos das mulheres, mas não só das mulheres, também das pessoas LGBTs, queer, dos negros e negras, dos indígenas com muita força. Nos Estados Unidos, a gente viu a questão do aborto agora. Como é que você enxerga isso, inclusive, a gente assistindo esse crescimento do machismo no interior dos movimentos de esquerda? Porque a gente vê hoje movimentos como o nacionalismo negro, ou o garveísmo, que vem aparecendo de certa forma por aqui. As influencers afro-americanas, inclusive, falam de Hotep, a partir desses movimentos. Então, a gente está vendo um crescimento também dentro da esquerda desse machismo, inclusive contra as mulheres negras, e um preconceito muito grande contra pessoas LGBTs, queer. Como é que você vê isso?
The way I see it, I'm going to come out. I feel like I'm trapped behind the table, if you don't mind. Okay, ooh, that's much better. All right. So you don't have to walk all the way over here. You could like stand there where people could actually see the next person. But what I would say to this is that I look at this as a long struggle. And social movements go through periods of time when they are visible and when they are not visible. Everyone assumes that a social movement that is not visible, there is no movement. But what's happening is it's in another phase, and it's responding to the nature of the threat that it faces because of its success. So very often when these far right, that's what how we're talking about it now, when they emerge and they seem to emerge from nowhere, that's not the case at all. They have been building for a while, and a lot of this is quite strategic. So the success of the last 50 years or so was the coalitions among blacks, women, queer folk, all of that, and social justice movements that democratized certainly the United States, major movements just to get the vote, which is now the struggle to take that back again, or reproductive rights. So the point is, there is never, ever an absolute victory. If you see history as linear and evolutionary, it's a straight line, and it's just going to get better and better and better and better, which is how the West, and particularly Western philosophy, likes to see the world, right? Since the Enlightenment, you would think, oh, we're going backwards. Whereas I see this as a continuation of a long-standing struggle that will never go away in my lifetime. Now, certainly it depresses me to, I have grandchildren, by the way. I have two lovely grandchildren. It depresses me when I think about my grandchildren inheriting this world that should have been much better by now for them. But I also recognize this is the struggle they have to take up, you see. So the generational period that we're in, how we actually handle this. Now, future talk, I will be talking a little bit about these issues. I think next talk about political solidarity. And this is the whole notion of how you think about coalitions or how you think about politics. And I'm going to be making an argument about why the far right is successful. They have a certain view of community that is quite different than I think when you think about a democratic community. I think that's what I'm going to do now that you asked this question. So, yeah. But anyhow, I just wanted to mention that this stuff is not new, right? It's not new at all. And when you read the arguments of the Nazis, these neo-Nazis are actually saying what the Nazis actually said, or the fascists. Or if you want to go back to the white supremacists after the Civil War in the US, you see really similar arguments made over time. So this is not a new struggle. What's fascinating now is the success is bringing, do you all know what, oh, I hate to use this example, I shouldn't say this. I want to use a roaches out of the woodwork example. Can I say that? Roaches out of the woodwork, can't say that. Okay, never mind. I'll write that someplace else in a thing. We're in a period of time now where the threat from the left, if you want to use that framework, is seen as a threat. As long as the perception was domination was still working, Why would you change anything? Sure, let in a few black people. Give a job to a black woman. Sure, let an indigenous person sit in the class. But when the threat became to be real in terms of power and changing policies around health and education, as has happened in this country quite impressively, I think, then that's a big threat. So in some ways, the victory of black feminism and intersectionality is tied to the fact that we hear so much about it now and where people want to tear it down because they're afraid of it. So I say, let's use this moment of visibility in the spotlight to strike. And that's the book I just finished on violence. There's a reason why I wrote that book and why it depressed me to do it, but I'm glad you asked that question because now I'm glad I did.
Pessoal, depois dessa fala, a gente vai fechar a fila, tá bom? Então, quem quiser vir, vem agora.
Boa noite. Não, primeiro, eu queria agradecer, né, a aula da professora Patrícia Hill Collins. Eu sou a Simone Nascimento, eu sou uma co-deputada aqui em São Paulo, né? Então, uma parlamentar no Brasil. A gente é de uma candidatura coletiva, chama Bancada Feminista, é uma experiência bem aqui frequente no nosso país. E também do partido da Marielle Franco, que é o Partido Socialismo e Liberdade. Aqui no Brasil, nos últimos anos, o feminismo negro tem dado uma contribuição muito importante para além de significar uma reorganização do próprio movimento negro ou uma cara mais evidente de quem é o sujeito da transformação social no nosso país, já que as mulheres negras são a maioria, tem conseguido também apresentar horizontes utópicos, como, por exemplo, a Marcha das Mulheres Negras, que conseguiu colocar para o Brasil o termo bem viver numa perspectiva de transformação radical. A própria Marielle era de um partido, né, que é Partido Socialismo e Liberdade, e a Lélia Gonzalez, que é fundadora do Movimento Negro Unificado, ajudou a construir a ideia de que movimento negro no Brasil é uma coisa de esquerda, uma coisa que vai numa perspectiva anticapitalista. Eu queria perguntar para você, dentro dessa perspectiva estratégica do feminismo negro interseccional, qual é a sua visão de utopia para a ruptura desse sistema tão machista contra as mulheres negras e contra a população negra na diáspora?
I'm not a person that has utopian visions. I'm a pragmatist. And the reason I've been able to keep going as long as I have is because I don't see every victory as permanent, nor do I see every defeat as permanent. And if I thought about moving toward a utopia that I was imagining, I would have to imagine with the tools that I currently have. And I'd have to imagine it with the people who are currently born. And I don't know what that would look like. I think that would limit how I think about it. At any point when I feel I have all the right answers and I have a script and a playbook I need to follow, whether it is a philosophy or whether it is a story or whatever, I am going to be analytical about that. And the thing to be most analytical about is the thing you believe in most deeply, you see. Because other than that, you can develop blind spots about your own project or your own vision of the world and become what the right is. They have huge blind spots about their own rightness in the world. They have a utopic vision. So when you ask, what is my utopic vision, I don't want to replace one of the right with one of the left that actually has the same cognitive limitations because of how it's actually working to bring about change. So that's how I approach it. And I'm going to stay with that.
Boa noite. Obrigada, primeiro de tudo. Fiquei muito emocionada com a aula. E meu nome é Natasha, eu sou uma mulher trans negra. Oi. Boa noite. Primeiramente, obrigada pela aula, foi muito emocionante. Meu nome é Natasha, eu sou uma mulher trans negra, e o Brasil é o país que mais mata pessoas trans. E a grande maioria dessas pessoas que são assassinadas são mulheres trans negras. Eu queria queria pedir que a senhora falasse sobre a importância do feminismo reconhecer a luta das pessoas trans e também como lidar com o sentimento de desumanização e não deixar que ele te paralise.
Thank you for sharing that. Obrigada. Oh, never right. Heard myself say something. Thank you for sharing that. Because the book that I have just finished on violence, I have a section, not big enough, but I have a section on trans women of color in the US and why they are the target of violence. Exactly what you have just said. And that came about because someone came up to me in a talk when I was in Brazil and grabbed my arm and said, "You do realize they're killing us." And I thought, okay, I'm just gonna have to do better. So the argument is one of this. Trans people who are out and who are visible and who are vocal run the risk of violence greater than other people who are just simply out and visible and vocal. And when trans people of color claim being trans and visible and out and vocal and are of color or are black, they are challenging everything. You are such a threat to everything. And to find another way to live where you find joy in your own body, you're living in an honest body, as June Jordan would say. You're not living in somebody else's body. You're claiming your own power. This is incredibly threatening to people who have a vested stake in keeping racism the way it is, or keeping sexism the way it is, or keeping homophobia the way it is, or keeping families the way they are, or religions the way they are, or communities the way they are. A lot of people have a lot of stake at the fact that there may not be a utopic vision. They can't see this because the utopic vision is already here. And it's somebody else who's bringing the gift to everyone who is living in a real and honest body. And that's what everybody should be able to do, to love who you want and to live in an honest body. All of us should want that. But the fear that keeps people from pushing to that point. So the violence is not coming from anything that trans women of color are doing whatsoever. It is really shining a spotlight and holding a mirror up to the need for a deeply radical intersectional analysis of the societies that we live in. The radical potential is there. And unfortunately, people die. That's the violence that comes at the tail end of the domination and the dehumanization. But turning that around, and the people who have lived joyously and openly, even though they knew they were at risk, and the gifts they have given us, for me, that's been very important to learn. So thank you for bringing that up. I feel very strongly about this, right?
Boa noite. Professora, que honra mesmo poder... Que honra poder presenciar essa aula e esse momento. Eu não tenho nem muitas palavras, mas eu tenho uma pergunta. E ouvindo a aula, eu, principalmente quando a senhora estava falando sobre esperança, me lembrou muito o livro da Bell Hooks, que fala sobre o amor. E o amor, não como acho que é tradicionalmente entendido, ou pelo menos como passava na minha cabeça, né, como um sentimento, mas como uma ação e uma ação política acima de tudo. E queria saber se a senhora podia falar um pouco sobre essa conexão, né, então, entre a noção de amor que a Bell Hooks expressou e a esperança, e também a potência dessas duas ações quando elas não são levadas de uma maneira utópica, né? Acho que já foi abordado um pouquinho essa questão, mas então como a gente pode levar isso para a política, né? Para a ação mesmo. Muito obrigada.
Early on, when I was writing, where did you go now? There you are. Okay. So I turn away, and all of a sudden, I don't know where people are anymore. Early on, when I was writing, I was so focused on intellectual issues, political issues through social institutions, and I was poo-pooing things like emotion, because love is often put in that category, feelings, hope, all that squishy stuff, until I realized that that is very much part of the foundation of politics. And the people who have just been in the trenches, the description would be like, they've been in the war all along, are those who care deeply. So the notion of care and caring doesn't come intellectually. You can't convince yourself, I mean, universities want to pay people to care about other people. All right, that's what they want, to perform caring. All right. But you can't pay someone to care about something because that's something they choose to do freely or not. It's in the person, and caring and love go together. So I taught school years and years ago. I taught middle school, and I said, you can't teach a child you don't love. And it sounded like, well, you can't love these children. Of course you can love these children. Now, they were bad. They were acting badly. I'm not saying they weren't badly behaved, which they were, all right? But the notion of seeing the potential, loving the person, and staying with that person no matter what. In part of my work, I write about this as mother work. This is the kind of work that mothers do for their children or for other people's children, or somebody did it for you, you do it for someone else. And it's not a sacrifice. Part of it is like a sacrifice, you're giving up this, you're giving up that. But it's really something that comes from a very deep place of care and social justice. The willingness to take on the world out of love for someone else. So much of the anti-violence stuff that I came across in researching this book were people who cared about people who died. And they said, I'm going to carry on in the memory of this person because I loved this person who was my child or who was my wife or who was my baby who never got a chance to grow up because of the country where I gave birth or my partner gave birth to this baby. So the whole notion of love and caring and hope being foundational to politics, and particularly to intergenerational politics, where people, there's so many, the strategies will change that are the political strategies. 100 years ago, we had no electricity to speak of, we had no internet, we had none of that, all the things that people think are essential now that provide strategic opportunities to do things differently. So the strategies will change. Wars are fought totally differently now than they were 100 years ago in terms of the weaponry that's available. You know, we don't line up anymore and just shoot people with muskets and stop and reload. I mean, there's none of that kind of thing. So the strategies will change, but if you see the essence of the through story, which is that's wrong and I have to do something about it, either for myself or someone else, the social justice is the through story. And for Black people, I would argue, it's a through story that is very much about freedom. That says, when I am free, really, when a Black woman is free, you will be free. And I heard the expression, one of the most radical things you can do is love a Black woman. Ooh, it's pretty radical. Because it's the same idea, you know, it's sort of, no, I'm simply refusing to accept the ideas that are around me. Because I care, because I love. And some of our great thinkers have actually gotten out of it. Like, I think Huey Newton talked about something called revolutionary love and love for the people, all right, and was thinking about ways to translate that love into something that's collective and political, all right. So, so we'll see what happens with that, okay?
Queria agradecer a presença da professora aqui e a oportunidade de poder estar nesse espaço. Eu sou formada pela Universidade Federal do Sergipe, mas faço mestrado aqui no Sudeste, na Unesp. Então, é uma oportunidade única estar perto de uma professora como a professora Patrícia. Meu nome é Angel e a minha pesquisa ela tem foco a discussão do conceito de gênero e corpo no campo das relações internacionais para compreender políticas de controle dos corpos. E pensando na relação do local e o global que você comentou, queria saber como o feminismo negro e o conceito de interseccionalidade pode auxiliar o estudo da política internacional, no sentido de produzir uma política em contraposição à que já existe sobre o controle dos corpos dissidentes.
There is no way I can answer that question. There is no way I can answer that really wonderful question so late in the evening. The only thing that is helping me is I know I'm going to think about your question and weave it into one of the upcoming talks. But I will say this, the whole idea of how to use intersectionality more effectively really is the question of now being specific about it, which is what you're asking. If you wanted to solve this particular problem, how would you apply it? How would you use it? And that's the creativity of each person. So that's basically your project that you're asking me to talk about, which is a good thing because now I know about it. And I will also just, I have to pull out the name of the student. 5 years ago, I did a seminar on intersectionality at, Pookie in Rio, and I had a student named Marco who turned out to go to law school and write a book, and he wrote a book about intersectionality in law, and he showed me his book. So the whole notion of as you make your way through and sharpening your question and sharpening all of this is important. So I'm dodging your question tonight, but I'm promising since I'll be here 3 more weeks, if you come to a future lecture, I want you to ask that one again. Okay, early. You can cut in line. You tell people, I was here, you know, last week. Tell them that.
Oi, meu nome é Nalanda. Assim como as minhas outras colegas, eu gostaria de agradecer pela aula. É uma honra, de verdade. E a pergunta que eu queria fazer é sobre hipersexualização. Porque quando a gente pensa sobre hipersexualização no Brasil, a gente tem o pensamento da Lélia, que vai falar sobre a mulata no carnaval. E é uma figura de uma mulher negra de pele clara que é hipersexualizada e enxergada como objeto de desejo sexual. E a pergunta que eu queria fazer... como essa hipersexualização ela é discutida no contexto nacional estadunidense e de que forma?
Two things I think I would say. First of all, it's a it's still an important topic. But I think what's been going on is a deeper appreciation of how hypersexualization of Black women manifests itself, all right, in so many ways. So the attention, the increasing attention to the work on Black girls, the notion of the hypersexualization of the bodies of young Black women in particular, and the treatment of women, the slide I had up here was that, exactly that. All right, those two slides were that. All right. So the notion of, I guess the issue is this is so deep. And increasingly I think about it in terms of how Black women's hypersexualization fits within the constellation of sexualization of the bodies of other women, and how that fits within sex trafficking, how that fits within all of those practices that in some ways take meaning from the body of Black women, We want you to be like black women. We want you to act like black women, but look like white women. We want you to. So it isn't just something that affects black women, although it does, but it's also much bigger than black women. So to me, it's one of those issues that is both particular, or not an issue, but it's a, I don't want to say a problem. It's just sort of an ongoing, you have to work on it. All right, that kind of thing is a task that is both particular to black women, depending on where black women are located and depending on the age and the sexuality of the women. Are we talking about Brazil? We were talking about, you know, Carnival. What about black women that I see? Oh my gosh, the pop culture, the stuff I see on television is amazing. I see more half-naked black women, like everything is flying around. It's just like the hypersexualization of some of that, of some of those shows that are quite different than what you would see in other places. So the hypersexualization really travels now in ways that it couldn't travel before. So those are some random thoughts that as I, you know, I have all that time in the car on the way back, I'll say, darn it, I should have said this, I should have said that. All right, but as I said, I'm here for a while, and this is something I'll think about and think about how I want to talk about this, all right, in future talks. Thank you. I'm still thinking.
Boa noite, eu sou a Bruna, sou pesquisadora de mestrado na USP, eu estudo poesia de escritoras negras, eu estudo Maya Angelou, Conceição Evaristo, Noema de Souza e Conceição Lima, e nós vamos fazer uma pergunta em dupla, então o KJ vai complementar.
Boa noite, eu sou KJ, sou pesquisador também lá na USP, eu pesquiso poesia preta periférica, poesia de slams e saraus, e as poetas enquanto pessoas e corpos negros, dissidentes de raça e gênero, produtores de epistemologias também. E, para além disso, eu queria muito agradecer a pergunta que a resposta que a senhora deu para a colega Natasha sobre pessoas trans, porque me toca e me ressoa em muitos outros lugares. Mas a nossa pergunta é que a senhora citou Conceição Evaristo, e como nós dois somos pesquisadores do grupo de pesquisa Corpos Estéticos em Diferença, que é encabeçado pela professora doutora Conceição Evaristo na USP, enquanto nossa catedrática, nós gostaríamos de agradecer em nome dela, em primeiro lugar, que a gente já avisou ela correndo, e em segundo, particularmente a gente pesquisa o conceito de escrevivência enquanto escrita negro feminina, que parte de um corpo negro feminino e vai para além representando todo um povo negro. Então, nós entendemos hoje que a escrevivência é a escrita de nós, junto com a professora Conceição. Então, nesse sentido, a gente gostaria de perguntar para a senhora como que a arte pode contribuir nas nossas lutas políticas que nós estamos construindo, pensando que nós não precisamos escolher entre ser intelectuais e ativistas, como a senhora já colocou. E a arte tem um papel fundamental, principalmente para nós negros sobrevivermos na academia. Obrigada.
I don't know what I would say beyond what you just said, to be honest with you, because how do you keep going without art? I mean, art to me is beauty. I mean, it's sort of what's beautiful in the world. It allows, depending on the art, the beauty of the spirit or the honesty that comes out in poetry. This is why I can't write poetry. I have to really admire people who do, because it's so visceral very often. So, you know, it comes from a deep place. When somebody does art and it touches you, whether it's a dance or a song or a poem or a film or a spoken word event or a play, and this, when I start going, or fashion, I mean, sometimes you can see someone walking down the street, it's artistic, or the street art that I bring out, that I'm mentioning, because I think this is a fascinating city for street art kind of thing. Tour, take me on a tour, all right. But yeah, the thing is, we're not used to thinking about art as being deeply political, whereas I happen to see the artists as the visionaries of social movements. That's where you see the ideas that are ahead of those of us who come after the artists. And this is one reason that societies that are hierarchical don't support their artists, because they don't want to see that kind of art or hear that kind of art. They want to contain that kind of art. Paint what I want you to paint. Sing what I want you to sing. It's the big struggle within hip hop in terms of an art form that starts off as a particular form and can be commercialized and turned into something else. So the struggle's there. So there's just what also art does is art has the potential to speak to people across all of these categories. Art travels across national categories way more than people think it does. Because art itself, people are influenced by other artists. I like your sound, that's a different sound. Maybe I'll put it in my song. I like your movement, maybe I'll get it in my, you know, I mean, it just, it goes places and you cannot contain imagination. That's the thing, you can't contain it. You can try and put it on retainer and say, only use imagination when I pay you to imagine. But I don't think it works that way. Why are we still looking at things that artists have done time immemorial? A lot of people read the Bible, by the way, because there's beautiful poetry in there. And we don't think about the Bible as the Songs of Solomon and I Love You. I mean, we don't think about all this stuff that's in there. All the other stuff, I know what that is, right? But the point of, so I think we've got to find a better way as academics to pull together people across the university to have a better understanding of what the others do. So the assumption that if you're speaking to the prime minister, you have his or her ear, that's more important than you're writing a poem, not necessarily in terms of the number of people you can actually reach and change in ways that cannot be undone. Because you can have a law, and the next year you don't have that law anymore. Then what do? But once you've thought a thought and felt something that comes from a deep artistic place, that's with you forever. And for me, that comes from the wonderful place of growing up African American, yay, and having people in my family who were artists, who sang and who danced and who did comedy like that. You know, I'm like, talk smack about you. So there's a whole lots of ways you can do things. So this is where the appreciation comes from. It isn't just art appreciation in school. It is profoundly political and enabling people to keep going from one generation to the next. The term that I use somewhere in my work is cultural politics. Culture is a site of activism. It's just not often thought about that way if the themes don't appear to be, quote, political. Okay. Thank you for that, the two of you together.
Boa noite, meu nome é Laura, eu sou estudante de História aqui na Unifesp. Gostaria de dizer primeiro que é um prazer estar aqui presenciando isso, não só com você, mas também com a professora Jaqueline, que, se não me engano, deu a matéria sobre racionais lá na Unicamp, que foi super importante, né, trazer o hip-hop para a universidade, para esse espaço institucionalizado, que a gente sabe que normalmente o hip-hop fica fora. E isso foi muito importante, você é um exemplo, então gostaria também de salientar aqui que você é incrível. Bom, e a minha pergunta é que, assim, aqui no Brasil as relações de poder elas estão muito ligadas à religião, né? Não à toa o último presidente usava Deus, pátria e família e a religião católica como justificador dos seus atos e os seus preconceitos. E quando a gente olha a escravidão aqui no Brasil, uma grande forma de resistência se deu a partir das religiões de matriz africana, que continuam até hoje, né? Umbanda, Candomblé, Jurema e tal, que até hoje sofrem preconceito, mas nunca deixam de resistir. As pessoas pretas aqui retornam ou encontram a ancestralidade através das giras, do atabaque, dos orixás e entidades. Não só isso, mas as religiões de matriz africana são exemplo de interseccionalidade quando unem a ancestralidade preta, as figuras femininas à frente da religião, como as mães de santo, e a caridade, colocando a classe como um fator determinante nesse espaço. Até hoje, o conflito com as religiões hegemônicas católicas é constante. A destruição de terreiros, intolerância religiosa, que infelizmente continua muito forte e se fortaleceram durante o governo Bolsonaro. Então, a minha pergunta é como você vê a religião nessa estrutura de poder e violência, seja no contexto americano, mundial ou específico aqui no Brasil. E é isso. Obrigada. Muito axé.
These questions keep getting harder as the evening goes on, because you've had more time to think about them and write them down now, right? This is a great question, and I would really love to say more about it. I'm just going to just dig in a couple places. I think the thing we've got to realize is religion is a really powerful tool for building community, but what kind of community? Building a community of people who are followers, or building who there's a leader and we all do what Pastor said. There are many evangelical, I'm concerned about the evangelicals in terms of their willingness to follow without questioning a bit more. And then on the other hand, we've got Catholicism, which has all these tensions in it, and you've described that, along with liberation theology. There's a lot of stuff in there. And then we have the African religions that managed to survive in Brazil that did not survive in the US, but influenced other religious traditions in the US. So they're not often recognized as African as much as here. So religion is not something that we can just walk away from, because that's where people are. And they're in very different religious groups, asking the question, what does religion do for people that the secular world does not? Why are they there? Why? What meaning is provided through religion to the kinds of questions that people are asking? And once I start looking at religion that way, and I assume everybody is there for a reason and they are rational thinking beings. They may be there because they were raised in a religion and can't imagine anything beyond it. They may be there because they chose it later on in life, or they continue to choose it because it provides meaning. So I just think that's the beginning of where I would start thinking about the meaning of religion. Because other than that, you end up picking a camp and you end up saying anyone who's in a religion that I don't understand somehow is, I don't want to try and understand, particularly the people who have been convinced that they are the true believers, they have all the right answers, no one else has anything to say. And when that gets appropriated or manipulated by a political figure or figures, when a political group realizes that religious fervor is a really good framework for getting people to develop political fervor. The fascists in Italy and in Germany were very good at this, in saying us, them thinking. Now that us, them thinking is not just confined to religion, but it takes a particularly dangerous form when it's cloaked in religion. So I would want to know more about these varying religious traditions and the threat that they pose to each other. If there were no threat, there would be no issue of shutting religions down and chasing. There would be plenty of space for us to believe and care about what we want to do. So I'll just start with that as a beginning of how I would start cutting into all of that. And again, this is an area I really need to know more about. Apparently, I've been circling around a religion for quite some time in my work without realizing it. So we'll see what happens after this trip. Thank you.
Primeiramente, boa noite. Foi linda aqui a sua aula. Meu nome é Antônio, sou estudante de História aqui na Unifesp. E, bem, a sua fala, sobre interseccionalidade, foi muito pontuado a questão sobre pensar políticas públicas enfim, para mulheres pretas, enfim, pensando, enfim, o feminismo, feminismo negro em seus diferentes contextos. Nisso você falou muito sobre o contexto nacional que essas políticas públicas, não só políticas públicas, mas cada lugar tem, né? E, enfim, eu queria ouvir sobre o contexto nacional dos Estados Unidos. Enfim, pensando um pouco sobre como fazer política pública nos Estados Unidos, pensando esse lugar, né, da interseccionalidade, tendo em vista que nos Estados Unidos a gente vê barreiras políticas grandes, né? O Partido Democrata, enfim, ele tem suas questões. Você apontou sobre os movimentos sociais também, que são super importantes, mas como que nós disputamos esse espaço de política nos Estados Unidos, tendo em vista que, enfim, a política, seus problemas, como que o partido se organiza, como que a direita disputa esse partido, enfim, queria ouvir um pouco sobre isso.
I think what happens with thinking about the United States is similar to what happens when people in the United States think about Brazil. They think about everything as a national issue. Okay. And my talk tonight, I did present the container of the US as a national issue. But what I could not do was talk about the fact that it's United States. And there are 50 states in the United States. And what is happening now is issues of social justice and equity, reproductive rights, voting rights, all of that. We have a Supreme Court that is no longer favorable, we think, to those issues. So everything is getting kicked back to the states. And you could think, well, that's a bad thing. But what I think is beginning to happen that's very interesting is people are realizing in each state where they live, each city within a state, or each region within a state, that local politics and state politics really matter. There's been this moment of all social change had to occur by looking at the federal government. And Donald Trump fundamentally was the face of the change, but it's not like he did this by himself, the efforts to roll all this stuff back. So where have the struggles gone? Where are they going? Now, the social movements that I've talked about have never gone away. There's a whole there are local groups everywhere in every community that have been, you know, fighting the good fight for social justice for many years. But the question now is, within those same local communities, how are people viewing these changes? And there are some surprises that are beginning to happen. When you take something away from people that they assumed they were going to keep, this is a surprise to them. The state of Florida is fascinating in terms of what's going on there. You've got a governor who wants to run for national office and who's imposing a lot of cultural stuff there, coming down on trans kids, on voting. We don't librarians, teachers, people who basically are knowledge workers who are spreading these ideas of intersectionality and black feminism. We're not having any of that. And it's been interesting, the pushback that is beginning to happen, that is happening there, and is happening nationally, because it's becoming more apparent that with the Supreme Court decision that we had on reproductive issues, that wasn't safe. So I think there's a whole generation of people who are recognizing that they have to really think about growing up in a world that's quite different than they assumed. Now, how that plays out politically and how that will play out historically, those are questions for historians. And historians have a really difficult time studying things in the moment. That's why we're the sociologists who are doing that and the political scientists who are doing that. And the historians have to come along and say, you better make sure that we have the records of what exactly happened so we can tell this story in ways that are helpful to future people. A good example would be the congressional committee that was held about the insurrection. The January 6th, I think it is, the date's blocking. When people stormed the Capitol, the far right group, Proud Boys, stormed the Capitol, ran Congress down into a bunker because they wanted to not have the election be certified. Apparently you had something similar thought about here, but not actualized to the same degree. So the aftermath of that is really interesting. You can try that in the press, and the press is just, but you know, people have a short memory when it comes to current events. But when you have a congressional committee that decides it's going to investigate and turn over every single rock that goes on for 18 months and finds considerable stuff under the rock that goes into the historic record, and when you have a court system that has just this past week, 2 weeks ago, prosecuted and locked up, jailed leaders of the Proud Boy movement, which is the far right movement that, you know, patterns itself after this, you realize these are, it seems slow at the time, but they're really laying a foundation for where we're going next. As long as these democratic institutions are functioning and we don't have a coup, it'd be great if they function differently than they do, faster, fairer, all that. But it's still standing for now. Despite all the whole world is coming to an end kind of thing. You know, this is a long game. I said that earlier. And this is where the historians are really useful, because they can point out how this is a long game. And there have been many groups of people who have been in this exact same position, faced with similar choices. And what did they do? Okay, what would you have done if someone had come for your grandmother? If you were living in a place that you had a dictator to that degree, what would you have done during the dictatorship here in Brazil? What did those people do during that period of time? Such that Leila Gonzalez says, I can now speak freely because we can have social movements because the democracy is back. So historians need the long, they have to tell us the long game, and we can get insight from that. So that was a sociological answer to a historical question.
Primeiramente, obrigada pela aula e também por tudo que a senhora já escreveu sobre maternidade. Mostrar como a maternidade não é somente opressão e também uma fonte de potência. Prometo ser rápida na minha pergunta, que é, atualmente no Brasil tem uma discussão sobre se há algum tipo possível de compensação financeira para mães, especialmente as que são mais prejudicadas ao terem filhos, como as mães negras, periféricas, as mães mais pobres, e há discussões se é possível pagar um salário para as mães ou mesmo incluir isso na aposentadoria das mães. Eu queria saber se a senhora acha isso um caminho bom para se pensar ou se isso é mais uma armadilha que a gente pode cair. Obrigada.
This is the first I'm hearing of this. So this is definitely, I'm going to learn more about this now that I'm here, all right? Anything that's going to support women or caregivers in raising children and will ensure for their future, because they have done that, because they have not been in the labor market, or because they have not been able to be in the labor market steadily or a variety of ways. This would be a guaranteed minimum income. This is the whole idea of that for everybody, right? That you shouldn't have to be poor later on because of what you were doing early on. So, how the policymakers figure out that it is profoundly unfair to make your own grandmother live in poverty because she took care of you, if I put it that way, or your grandfather, who worked in a job that was, he died young. So she was left with children or is left with not having someone to share, whatever. I mean, it just seems like the economics of it all should be based on fairness. And what I would say is this, I believe that when you do things that are good for Black people, they help everybody. Now the perception is somehow Black people are taking things from other people that they have unfairly earned. You know, they didn't work or they didn't do this, that, and the other. No, the whole notion of if you give a quality education to a Black child, you know what an quality education is, and you give that to every child. So that's kind of the way I look at not adding Black people into what's already there, but saying, what if we do this, how will it make it, how will we see other ways of doing things for everybody that we hadn't considered? So we got to go beyond our own racism and sexism and history and all of that. So with this particular proposal, I don't know what the details are. If the fact that you're asking about it as, is it a trap, says to me, there's potentially a trap there somewhere. But but I can't speak to that part.
Oi, professora, boa noite. Meu nome é Alice, eu faço pedagogia aqui na Unifesp. E eu estou um pouquinho nervosa, então, se eu perder nas minhas ideias, eu também não anotei nada. A minha pergunta não é bem uma pergunta, é mais um comentário que eu venho pensando há muito, muito tempo, que eu já discuti com algumas mulheres pretas, que é como não existe espaço para uma mulher preta feminina. E quando eu digo feminilidade, não é essa feminilidade sexualizada, não existe espaço para a mulher preta ser uma pessoa delicada. Não existe espaço para a mulher preta ser uma pessoa que quer ser cuidada. E isso eu não vejo... Exatamente. Não existe espaço para a gente ser frágil. E, assim, eu acho que dá para ver. Eu sou uma pessoa muito feminina. Eu gosto de ser feminina. E eu sinto que, quando eu converso com... Eu tenho um certo problema com relacionamentos afrocentrados, porque quando eu converso com homens pretos, eu sinto que eles veem como se eu estivesse me embranquecendo. E quando eu converso com homens brancos, eles me desejam por parecer que eu estou me embranquecendo. Por parecer que eu estou me embranquecendo. Então, é mais um comentário sobre isso. E eu entendo que é difícil para homens pretos... Se é difícil para a mulher preta demonstrar feminilidade... demonstrar delicadeza e sentimentalismo, imagina para homens pretos que foram foram socializados de maneira violenta. Mas outro comentário que eu queria fazer é que, se para a mulher preta já é difícil ser feminina tal qual uma mulher branca pode ser, imagina para um homem preto gay. Entende? Então, quando um homem preto gay ele é afeminado, ele é feminino, ou ele não é visto como homem, ou ele não é visto como uma pessoa preta. Então, a minha pergunta, que não é uma pergunta, é mais sobre isso, sobre a gente não poder ser frágil, a gente sempre tem que ser forte, sexy, sensual, e só não poder ser frágil. É isso. Obrigada. Exatamente.
You know, I just wish I could just make you 10 years older. And I'm saying that because I think you've got to realize that you're in the center of your own life. And I heard so much about you talking about all these constraints, how you're perceived by other people. This one perceives me this way. This one perceives me that way. This one has been damaged, so he perceives me this way. This one has been violent, so he perceives me this way. This one has been, so I can't be who I want to be in the middle of my own life as I figure this out. So when I say 10 years, I'm thinking, taking the time to really build around you the people who see you for who you are. The rest of these people don't matter. They matter if they get in your way. They matter if they make life difficult for you. But no, people who are not supporting you do not actually see you and have your best interest at heart. And there's so many people who you may be walking by because of the concern with all of these bigger issues. This is almost like, I'm not saying, I don't want to make this like a, oh, just find yourself. I'm not saying that. I'm saying fragile means you want to be taken care of, and is there reciprocity in that? That you're also taking care of someone else who may be fragile. You trade off when you need to. Someone's strong, someone's weak. That's known as a relationship, right? That's what happens in what I would consider a relationship that works for people. But it's really, you're absolutely right. It is very difficult to kind of push away all of those social messages, particularly if other people are coming to you with those messages. I write about this around something called controlling images, and the whole set notion of ideas that people may have about others and themselves that control their behavior. And once you have a better sense of what all that is, you can begin to craft how you want to fit into all of that. But you're at the center of your own life. You are the boss of you. Okay, no one else is the boss of you. You are the boss of you. And, you know, so I say you need to be your own boss and say, I'm going to boss myself, but not other people. You know, my freedom cannot rest on someone else's domination, subordination. That's not freedom. And all the people who say to you, well, you have to be subordinate to me in order for me to be with you, you say, well, bye. All right. So, and you find that there are quite a few people out there who are willing to look beyond these categories. All right, so that's what I would say. And I just want to save you the pain and suffering of all the looking. That's what I'm trying to say. Oh, no, don't do that to her. She's so sweet, you know, kind of thing. All right. But yeah, all right. So that's a really interesting question. So, obrigada. Para a sua pergunta. Ah!
Yes, venceu, né? A última. Bom, oi, tudo bem? A última chegou, né? Vai dar para dar uma relaxada. É, boa noite para todo mundo também. Eu também queria agradecer pela sua fala, foi incrível, acrescentou a todos que ouviram, eu tenho certeza disso. E tanto na sua fala como nas perguntas, né, foi muito pontuada essa questão da violência. E a senhora falou muito sobre a questão também da esperança, né? E no contexto que a gente está, principalmente aqui no Brasil, essas constantes violências que a gente sofre, às vezes é muito difícil ter esperança. Então, eu queria saber da senhora como que a gente faz para alimentar essa esperança e, além disso, como usar essa esperança como estratégia também para se fortificar nesse processo de luta, né? Eu acabei me enrolando na pergunta, mas eu esqueci de falar, eu sou a Aline, eu faço história, e eu também faço parte do núcleo negro aqui da universidade. Então, essa questão da esperança como estratégia mesmo é muito importante para a gente se fortificar para continuar nessa luta, né? Eu queria saber um pouco sobre, da senhora sobre isso. Obrigada. Boa noite, gente.
I think that's a wonderful question to end on. So I'm glad you're last. Because in many ways, it's really the question we each have to ask ourselves. And I don't know if there's I want to think about this some more. I'm going to give you a preliminary answer, but then I'm going to be thinking about this because of you've asked this question. But when I ask what gives me hope, you. Anyone who is... I've been teaching my entire life. I see the good in people, and I certainly see the awful. I'm not saying that. But I also am hopeful because I know who's coming. And I don't think I can lose hope and do what I do. I think I would be inauthentic, I would be lying, I would be a fake. I have to believe that what I do makes a difference, even if I don't see the outcome right away. And this is what was really useful to me early on writing Black Feminist Thought, because I was doing research of women who had done research about all these women who had done all these things, but we didn't know about them. And we were finding out about them and the things that they had done. No one had written about Ida Wells Barnett, but she left her own autobiography so we wouldn't forget her. And what I found was this whole tradition of women, black women, and I think this is also true for pretty much any group, we don't know who came before and what their hopes and dreams were for themselves and for us. So Alice Walker, I believe, says something like, my mother prepared me to go into a world that she couldn't imagine was possible, but somehow she prepared me because she hoped and she dreamed. But we don't know what her dreams were. We might have known what they were for herself, that she never got to live. But so the whole notion of hope is giving someone a gift of your best you and hoping that it will be enough for them, but that down the road, someone you don't even know will come along and say, ah, it was Eleni, is that your name? Eleni? See, that's your name, see? Eleni? Someone will be coming and saying, Eleni was here. I'm so glad she was here. I'm so glad I got a chance to meet her. I'm so glad I got a chance to read something she did or read her poetry or whatever it is. So we each can make a mark on the world with hope. Not hope is like this fake thing, but that kind of deep caring is hopeful. The motherhood question, the mother work question is all about that. So I don't write about that enough. I probably should write about that some more. So I'm, you know, it's in the talk and I'm thinking, I haven't written about that lately. I need to pick up my pace. So thank you very much. Obrigada. Para su pregunta. Obrigada a todos. Para su atención. Você é incrível.
Obrigada, Patrícia. Obrigada a todos.